Have you taken a ride in an electric car? If not, don't worry. Ride-hailing companies are bringing electric vehicles to your city pretty soon. On this episode, you will hear about the electric fleet operated by Ola in the Indian city of Nagpur. Hello and welcome to yet another show on the podcast platform of Mission Shunya. I am Girish Shivakumar. First, a big thanks to all the listeners who gave this podcast a rating and wrote a review on iTunes and Apple Podcast. Your ratings and review help the podcast reach a wider audience. It also helps me make the podcast better. So, if you haven't done so, please do it now. Thanks for spreading the word. Now, on to this week's show. In 2017, Ola started a pilot project of a kind. It rolled out electric vehicle fleet in the Indian city of Nagpur. The fleet was mostly Mahindra electric cars and a few auto rickshaws. It's been over 2 years now, and in the process, Ola claims to have served around 350,000 customers and has driven 7.5 million clean kilometers and has mitigated over 1,000 tons of carbon in the process. The project has been running and it's been successful so far. As you would expect, in the early days the project had its own set of problems, be it the regulatory hurdles, the technical challenges in setting up the ecosystem, gaining confidence of the driver community, which is of great importance for a fleet aggregator, and so on. Recently, Ola Mobility Institute, a subsidiary of Ola, published a report that summarized the project and laid out a set of recommendations. On this episode, Aishwarya, Raman and Nitish, Arora, who authored the report, join me to discuss more about the report and about the recommendations that it has laid out. So, let's listen in to what they had to say. Hello Aishwarya and Nitish, glad to have you on the Mission Shunya podcast.
Thanks Girish for having us.
Let's start with a story. Let's start with the history of the pilot project that you started in Nagpur. So Ola started this project in 2017 and you recently released a report highlighting the important issues that you had and the success stories of the project so far. Can you begin with sharing a brief background of the study?
Sure, absolutely. So Ola, as all of us here would know, is the country's largest ride-sharing platform. Two summers ago, it launched India's first multimodal electric mobility project in Nagpur. Multiple stakeholders, including the state and the central governments, businesses, and driver partners, of course, partnered with Ola to deploy a fleet of electric rickshaws and electric cabs in the city. Ola then went ahead and set up a series of charging stations for e-cabs and swapping stations for e-rickshaws. It also partnered with the Indian Oil Corporation to set up a charging facility at their fuel station. So as of January 2018, around the time that Ola Mobility Institute started understanding and analyzing Ola's project in Nagpur, the project had completed nearly a year and a half since its inception, and the fleet of electric vehicles had achieved a lot. Starting from one, the fleet had served over 350,000 customers in the city of Nagpur. It had clocked over 7.5 million clean kilometers. It had saved over 5.7 lakh liters of import-dependent fossil fuel and reduced carbon dioxide emission by over 1,230 tons. So these were some of the environmental as well as socioeconomic impact aspects of India's first electric mobility project, electric mobility fleet in Nagpur. There have been other sort of achievements as well, if you may call them that, which included helping the entire ecosystem answer a few fundamental questions, including how does the charging of batteries of EVs vary by season, time of day, etc. How can a fleet drive customer adoption of EVs? what should the model of engagement with drivers look like, so on and so forth. So these sort of questions prompted Ola Mobility Institute to conduct a study of the country's first electric mobility project. And just a couple of weeks ago, we also released the report.
Those are really great numbers. I mean, talking of about like 3.5 lakh customers being served in electric platform, those are really good numbers. Now, looking at just the vehicles per se, what are the type of vehicles that were deployed? I'm sure there were a couple of variants. I mean, one was for cars and you also had rickshaws plying. How many vehicles in totals and how many driver partners in the process were involved in this project?
When Ola launched its fleet in Nagpur, the intent was to deploy 200 vehicles in the short run and over 10,000 vehicles in the long run. However, only nearly half of the short-term target was met. While all the vehicles, you know, had corresponding drivers, that meant we had roughly 100 drivers as well who were working with us and continue to do so. While all the vehicles operate, scaling the electric fleet has been a huge challenge for the company, for the platform. Some of the roadblocks that we've also covered in detail in our report include aspects such as high electricity tariff, another cost that also cost a deterrent for scaling was land lease rental. So the electricity tariff, for example, just to elaborate on that, until a year and a half into operating EVs in Nagpur, the commercial or industrial tariff of 17 odd rupees needed to be paid to the per unit needed to be paid to the to cover our cost, electricity cost of charging vehicles. This, of course, burdened the system a lot and also made the project unviable. However, post that period, post September, October 2018, the government becoming cognizant of such a high electricity tariff helped create a special EV tariff, which helps us net out the cost at 8 rupees per unit, which is, of course, a huge improvement from the original 17 rupees per unit. But there is also room for further improvement here so that the project can become more viable and we're able to also achieve TCO parity with ICE vehicles. I think overall, while the intent still exists in Nagpur to scale the project, certain constraints around cost, as well as the models of vehicles and the existing charging solutions, have not helped the company scale the platform yet. However, now with the 2 years of learning from Nagpur, we, I think, are in a better position as a company, as a platform, to build scalable solutions outside of Nagpur as well as within.
Interesting. You bring out 2 points. One is Ola not being able to scale up this pilot project into projects in across multiple cities. But interestingly, you also mentioned that how government has changed the tariff and introduced a new tariff that is kind of favorable for electric vehicles. So I think that is an interesting step. How did this happen? Was the government supportive enough in this case?
So I think from the beginning, the entire ecosystem knew that the electricity tariff, for one, would be a huge roadblock. And at that point in time, there were a lot of interesting and favorable conversations with the state government. Several states, in fact, today are sort of competing with each other to be a first mover in the electric mobility space, and therefore are very open to hearing views from mobility actors themselves and e-mobility, for example, charging stations and swapping station operators themselves to understand what kind of a favorable regulatory environment could be created in their respective geographies. So having said this, in Nagpur, in Maharashtra, I think there have been multiple conversations with the state government. And since the chief minister himself was very involved right from the launch of the project, it was easy to actually arrive at the special EV tariff. A lot of other states, therefore, picked cue from Maharashtra and from their own experiences as well, and have started announcing special EV tariffs. Beyond the electricity tariff, we've had, I think, a lot of favorable regulations come about that helps ease the time and the process taken to set up charging station, for example, or the the process and the time taken to deploy electric vehicles. What kind of permit requirements do they have? What kind of licenses do they require to run on the roads? So I think all these are being addressed at both the central and the state governments. However, active conversations are important. More such pilots are required for the government to see evidence and then, you know, also again, believe in e-mobility, I suppose.
Nitish, would you like to add to that? So how did Ola go about setting up the infrastructure around Nagpur to enable this project happen?
So yeah, sure. So access to the charging infrastructure remains critically very important when it comes to mass EV adoption. So it becomes essential to create viable, dependable alternatives to the fuel pumps. But when you're looking at EVs, you need to understand whether to install a fast charger, whether to install a slow charger, because that actually affects your battery life. So what we did was, for optimal battery performance, the battery needs to be charged one time fast and one time slow. It could have the one fast and one slow. So what we did was that we identified first the high density location areas, demand areas. We identified those hotspots, mapped up this vis-a-vis the grid capacity where we could install a DT transformer and hence could install the fast charging options there. Similarly, to address the issues of range anxiety of the driver partners, we installed slow chargers at their home. So once the driver partner reaches home, it could plug in the car and could easily charge for over six hours during the night time or when he's off, essentially. So I think this is an approach the platform took about while building the in charging infrastructure ecosystem, because that remains what is critically important. And I believe the other cities going forward, we would continue with the same similar approach as we roll out more and more pilots around the EVs.
So that's good. That's good to know that you got the driver partners onboarded through this initiative by installing slow chargers in their location. So that is a positive step. In terms of the analysis that you come up at the end of this period, you throw up some numbers, like for example, the savings in terms of around 3 rupees per kilometer and about 4.5 rupees per kilometer for fleet and private use vehicles. How did you do this analysis over this period? What are the various factors that you considered? I'm sure like electricity tariff was one key factor, but what are the other factors that went into this?
So here, what one needs to understand is the total concept of total cost of ownership in order to reach the conclusion as to which vehicular segments and which use case is currently ready for electrification and which might still take some time. So for example, shared mobility use cases are the ideal candidates for the EV penetration to happen, because on the per day basis, they put in more kilometers. So they are in a position to leverage that low operational cost against is the high upfront cost and have a shorter payback time period. I think with this background, we tried assessing what are the operational savings for both the shared use case or the fleet provider vis-a-vis the private use case. Now, what assumptions and what calculations did went into this? For example, we talked about kilometers on the daily run kilometer. For example, in a private use case, I might drive only 50 to 60 kilometers a day, whereas for in a shared, a fleet operator drive almost 160 kilometers a day. Considering that we remain active for 26 days and monthly run for a fleet operator would come out to be 4,100 kilometers, whereas for the private use case would be 1,300 kilometers. Similarly, what we also estimated is that the fuel cost of switching from a fleet operator mainly operates currently on CNG based vehicles. So if the switch from CNG to the electricity would happen, in case of private, the switch from petrol or diesel to EVs, because that is the predominant case there. So what we realized that the total operational savings for a fleet operator would come around to be 3 rupees. And for a private use case, it comes down 4.5 rupees. Now, although the operational savings are still higher for the private use case because it does not need to establish or invest any capex on investment of building the infrastructure, it has a very high payback period. For example, if I drive small, shorter distances on a daily basis, in a private use case, I could only cover the high upfront cost in 11.5 year time. Whereas in a fleet operator which puts in more kilometers, I could cover the high upfront cost in just less than 5 years time. So these were the operational savings. Now, when you talk about how the electricity tariff had an impact on this, so what it's critical to understand is that electricity tariff mainly feeds into what? The fuel cost for an EV. So for example, we discussed earlier that in Nagpur, the delivered cost of electricity was around 17.7 rupees, because of which, if you look, that electricity expenses were forming over 30% of the total operation cost of the charging infrastructure. To address this problem, the remedy that we applied is that we started installing solar rooftops, particularly at the two highly utilized charging stations, one in at the airport and the second at the Nandanwan KDK. These solar rooftops are roughly a 15.2 to 16 kilowatt hour capacity. So what we see that after the installation of the solar rooftop, coupling this with the special EV tariff that the state created in the month of October 2018, the share of electricity expenses as a part of the total operational cost of a charging infrastructure came down from 30% to roughly 14.7%. And as far as the solar rooftop was concerned, they perform reasonably well. When I say that, because via solar net metering, we could feed back into the grid, which reduced our electricity expenses roughly by 28%. Now, I think the Nagpur pilot here provides a proof of concept at a time when the country is debating how it could power or fuel the sustainable mobility paradigm, whether EV is going to be clean only when powered with renewables, or they could still be green with coal. And if they needs to be supplied with the renewables, could this happen? Or are there any technical issues at the grid level that needs to be sorted out? I think here the Nagpur pilot provides a proof of concept. It works really well. And going forward, India could continuously build on that solar rooftop mission, coupling with the electric mobility system to build for a low carbon resource efficient future going forward.
So Ola as a company is predominantly driven by the driver partners. So they are probably your assets. And how did you get them on board for this kind of project? Electric vehicles and driver partners. I mean, it must be a first for both of you. So how did you give them confidence to join this program?
So for the drivers, there are multiple apprehensions, of course, when you introduce a brand new technology. One apprehension with regard to electric vehicles itself was, of course, the high upfront cost. This, in Ola's case, is resolved by allowing drivers to rent an electric vehicle from us, the fleet operator. And this, of course, was the case in Nagpur. And we are increasingly seeing that this is the model that will be adopted by the rest of the ecosystem as well in cities outside of Maharashtra too. So while the high upfront cost concern is addressed, there remain two more apprehensions, at least from our interactions with the driver partners. This is what we've learned. So the second bit was that Ola was increasingly worried about the slow adoption of a hitherto unknown technology among the drivers. However, the drivers instantly felt comfortable driving EVs and particularly enjoyed the smooth ride it offered, compared to their ICE counterparts of rickshaws or cabs. I think EVs, with its fewer moving parts and a much more smart a smarter sort of a dashboard was something that really excited our driver partners. And the smooth ride that they experienced, you know, without any bumps on the way, was a benefit that even our customers in Nagpur had highlighted. So this worry that we initially had as a fleet operator was sort of allayed by drivers' own interest in adopting this new technology. And lastly, and much more, and most importantly, the apprehension that drivers have is the time taken for charging. Be it slow charging for 6 hours or fast or super fast charging for 30 minutes or 2 hours, every minute spent at a charging station amounts to a loss of an earning opportunity for the drivers. So in the initial days when our solution 2 predominantly only had charging and did not necessarily explore swapping originally, we had to compensate the drivers for the time, for the idle time spent at charging stations. Therefore, I think holistically as an ecosystem, what we are looking for is a reliable and viable alternative to fuel stations. Stations with less queue, and charging completed within minutes. This is where we believe, and we strongly believe, battery swapping features as a critical solution to scale EV adoption in India. What swapping naturally lets you do is interchange a discharged battery with a fully charged battery within minutes. And thus, drivers are back on the road ferrying passengers or making deliveries, therefore earning a livelihood. So I think this was very important for us to ensure that the downtime could be reduced, the runtime was high, and then the earnings of the drivers too could be kept high. So our analysis, of course, tells us that as compared to an ICE vehicle, an EV is down 20 to 25% of the time because of the time taken to charge the vehicle. And I think swapping beautifully addresses this concern. So these were, I think, some of our initial learnings from the engagement with driver partners in Nagpur.
That perfectly leads to my next question, because when you got the report out, this recommendation particularly caught the attention of like the industry veterans and all the policymakers, because it went like saying Ola is recommending battery swapping. Now you rightly bring out the reason you don't want your driver partners to be left idle. Although EVs are really good for the fleet operators because they are, in terms of the total cost of ownership and the running cost, they are economical compared to the alternatives. Getting battery swapping on board must have its own challenges. So how do you plan to overcome this? Do you just say battery swapping is only going to be for the three-wheelers that you had in the project?
Understood. So I think what we've come to realize is that India is unique to the extent that the majority of our high utilization vehicles in the country are in fact your two-wheelers and three-wheelers, followed by four-wheelers and buses in a shared mobility environment. Therefore, for small segment of vehicles, two-wheelers and three-wheelers particularly, we vehemently recommend battery swapping as a reliable and a viable solution. So fleets of two-wheelers and three-wheelers used as bike taxis, for e-commerce and hyperlocal deliveries, passenger and goods mobility, etc., will definitely be the early adopters of electrification. Drivers of such fleets are in fact dependent on their vehicles for their livelihoods. Therefore, we realize that there is an absolute necessity to establish a dependable, convenient, and affordable replacement for petroleum products and fuel pumps, as was just discussed. We definitely see that battery swapping benefits trump a lot of the concerns that the ecosystem has around battery swapping. So what are some of the major concerns? Some of the major concerns are around battery degradation because of, you know, the manner in which you charge. Two, concern is around, you know, standardization of batteries as well. So as we've seen outside of India, some of the experiments in the last decade or so have involved battery swapping for four-wheelers. In such a case, you do require standardized batteries, but is the value chain ready to produce vehicles with standardized batteries, especially in the four-wheeler context? No. And we also don't aspire to push the ecosystem in that direction. What we, on the contrary, want to do is highlight the benefits of swapping and figure ways in which the entire ecosystem could adopt swapping for two-wheelers and three-wheeler segments. I think it's definitely then important to understand what these benefits are. Some of the benefits that we've ourselves seen, witnessed in Nagpur include, one, swapping, mimicking the experience of existing fuel pumps. In that, battery swapping is swift and convenient. Swapping eliminating waiting time for charging. Swapping increasing available runtime in a given day. Swapping sort of boosting driver earnings. Like I mentioned just a while ago, in Nagpur, battery swapping boosted driver earnings as they were able to operate the vehicle for 25% longer range compared to conventional lithium-ion battery-based vehicles, and 50% more compared to conventional lead-acid battery-based vehicles. So I think this is one of the hugest advantages swapping ecosystem gives to shared mobility actors. A few more benefits include swapping, reducing the total cost of ownership, as well as bringing down your sticker price of the electric vehicle, right? So imagine a scenario where the battery and the vehicle could be separated. So in that case, an electric rickshaw tomorrow would cost you only as much as an electric rickshaw costs you today. And there could be a separate entity that becomes the owner of batteries and is able to provide batteries on a need basis to its users. Similarly, battery swapping optimizes battery performance. Swapping is an energy efficient way of powering EVs. It provides grid balancing solution. Battery swapping operators tomorrow can act as storage units and therefore help build smart grid facilities across the country. And finally, we're also realizing as we set up more and more swapping stations, not just in Nagpur, but around the country, we're seeing that swapping is able to introduce new kinds of jobs, new businesses, new micro-entrepreneurial opportunities. I think in a way, swapping's advantages, like I said before, definitely trump some of the concerns the world has seen with swapping not working for the four-wheeler segment. But I think increasingly we are getting evidence from Ola's own operations in different parts that swapping's definitely reliable and viable for two-wheeler and three-wheeler segments.
That's a really good clarification that you have given in this podcast. So, I mean, people who listen to this probably know the details behind this recommendation. You clearly state it's going to be for two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And as I see it, a study like this, an analysis from a pilot project like this, should throw up such recommendations or should weigh the pros and cons of multiple options and then provide that in the recommendations. I'm glad that you have been able to bring this out in detail, one in the report and now in the podcast. So that's really good. Thanks for that. Now, looking at Ola's larger vision in this space, you clearly understand the economics of the running electric vehicles, the fleet business for electric vehicles, and you have seen some challenges. So how do you see this panning out? You obviously told that you wanted to scale up by a big factor in the early years, but how do you see it going forward? Do you have more pilots coming up, or how do you see this shaping up?
Again, you know, I speak for Ola Mobility Institute, and we sort of have an insight into how Ola Electric Mobility, a separate arm under Ola, is thinking about e-mobility. So I think their vision comes from Ola's belief in a sustainable future. Today, Ola is already building and reimagining mobility for a billion individuals. It is delivering mobility solutions at scale. Ola's platform helps millions of people make a living and get where they need to go every day. Ola has a real ability to enable clean kilometers traveled and achieve disproportionately high number of clean kilometers in a very short period of time. And this is precisely what a country like India requires today, given that a lot of our cities are suffering from polluted environments. Ola, therefore, is committed to being an early mover in making electric mobility viable, not just for our driver partners, but also for cities, and position it as a clean alternative to today's options. So what we are discussing in this podcast now is, of course, Ola being the first company to carry out a citywide EV pilot in 2017, as early as 2017 in Nagpur. And last year, what Ola did was also launch Mission Electric as a platform to deploy electric vehicles at scale. Through this platform, Ola and Ola's electric arm, Ola Electric Mobility, seek to partner with like-minded organizations who want to be active contributors in the shift to electric vehicles, and work together to accelerate the path to getting there. This includes potential buyers of vehicles, manufacturers, battery companies, and those who will deliver on the promise of e-mobility. These include your driver partners, of course, on the ground, as well as cities, thought leaders, researchers, academics, and so on. So as part of Mission Electric, something that we've also alluded to in our report, Ola has committed to putting 1 million electric vehicles on the road in the next 3 years. And it is our sincere endeavor to get multiple actors to join hands to multiply this commitment. I think something that you, Girish, mentioned just a couple of minutes ago was how, for a fleet operator, the operating cost of electric vehicle fleet is low, and that is a huge promise. I think that's precisely what Ola is betting on. Mobility for everyone needs to become sustainable mobility for everyone. And Ola intends to be a catalyst in making that an affordable reality. I think the underlying word here is definitely affordable. India is definitely in a position to leapfrog the historical evolution of personal mobility, and can achieve energy security, create millions of new jobs in the process, create new businesses with the potential to scale across the world. I think that's the overall vision. And I'm confident that, you know, some of my colleagues at the Ola Electric Mobility are working day in and day out to, in fact, put thousands of electric vehicles on road immediately, so that by 2021, 2022, we can actually see at least 1 million electric rickshaws and electric autos, electric bikes, electric buses on the road. So that's definitely the future.
Sounds really exciting. I mean, I can really feel the excitement because I'm also in the same space, and look forward to hear more about Ola Electric Mobility and see what its plans are. It'll be really good to have like 1 million vehicles in the next few years. And if just Ola is going to have 1 million vehicles, I'm sure the entire ecosystem will have, I mean, my guess is about 10 times the same amount of vehicles. So that's really a good thing. Finally, you also have a list of recommendations that has come out in the report. What was the logic behind those recommendations? What are your thoughts on that?
Thanks, Girisha. I think that's also one chapter of the report that we wanted to ensure was very comprehensive, but we also took the opportunity to ensure we were offering relevant evidence. And a lot of the evidence, in fact, comes from Ola's own Nagpur experience. So that is how I would like to start talking about the recommendations themselves. As one of the largest ride-sharing platforms in the world, Ola, and therefore through Ola today, Ola Mobility Institute, have a vantage point to understanding and shaping the future of mobility in India and elsewhere. Therefore, with the intent to help India become a golden example of electrification, as well as decarbonization of the entire transport sector, recommendations were offered in our report to not just accelerate EV adoption in the country, but also to think about integration with renewable energy, consider what would happen to end of life of vehicles and batteries, and offer our thoughts, of course, as a shared mobility actor and as a key enabler of the EV ecosystem towards the government and other regulatory authorities. So some of the recommendations that we've ourselves considered based on the evidence from Nagpur were, One, of course, that the success of e-mobility is hinged on leveraging shared mobility and other fleet-based operations. Therefore, our key message to a state government or the central government would be to promote ways in which fleet operators can transition to EVs seamlessly. Two, vehicle segment prioritization with an eye on TCO viability is at the heart of the EV adoption drive across the country. We've come to realize in the last 2 years that unlike the West, India may not kickstart its electric journey by subsidizing premium electric cars for wealthy early adopters. Small vehicles, as we all know, dominate Indian roads. Therefore, any attempt at electrification must address two-wheeler and three-wheeler segments that get people places every day. Additionally, Ola Mobility Institute's own analysis suggests that TCO advantages for four-wheelers is still years away and requires significant commitments to infrastructure, making it more resource efficient to naturally prioritize other segments, of course. Similarly, in the same vein, we talk about how governments should consider TCO parity being achieved in order to ensure that the e-mobility projects in the country are viable and sustainable. TCO parity is also important because only then can the government also introduce sunset clauses in its EV promotion policies. This is very important for a country like India, where a lot of, a significant portion of the budgets usually allotted for social projects, social welfare projects. And therefore, when you talk about, transportation and electrifying the entire transport sector, decarbonizing the entire transport sector, we've also got to ensure that this does not cause a huge burden to the exchequer. And therefore, we also are advocating for financial viability of projects and figuring out with government and regulatory authorities on how financial viability of projects can be achieved by making operationalizing of EVs really cost efficient. That brings me to the next point on how incentives should be designed so that they incentivize usage rather than purchase of EVs. I think this is also witnessed in the turn that FAME has taken, which is our central government's scheme to promote accelerated adoption of EVs in the country. So from FAME 1 to FAME 2, we are seeing that incentives are indeed being designed to promote usage of EVs rather than the purchase of EVs. Some of the ways in which state governments can also adopt this would be to, one that we extensively spoke about during this podcast, would be to maintain a really low delivered cost of electricity for charging vehicles and keeping it in the ₹5 per unit range for at least 4 to 5 years to make e-mobility projects more viable. Other ways are definitely, subvention of GST for charging and swapping, removing the minimum contract requirement for open access, encouraging renewable energy integration. As we saw in Nagpur, renewable energy integration allowed us to bring down the electricity cost by 25%. So I think there are multiple creative ways in which incentives on usage of EVs can be promoted. And a couple of our last points that we've covered in our report include how fiscal incentives should be designed to specifically subsidize the one cost that makes EVs expensive: batteries. So just a while ago, we discussed how battery swapping offers a huge promise for the country. And for that scenario to adopt and kick off, we definitely need batteries and vehicles to be treated separately and have fiscal incentives for batteries as well. So I think this is how, based on sort of our learnings from Nagpur, using Nagpur pilot's evidence, we've started writing our recommendations and, offering them as well through the report to central and state government officials. And I think as Ola's electric mobility platform continues to expand, we would have all the more learnings from such pilots. And I think those are those are definitely insights that Ola Mobility Institute is keen at sharing with the larger ecosystem.
Thanks, Aishwarya. That was a very comprehensive summary of the recommendations that you put out in the report. I'm sure for listeners who have not had a chance to look at the report, your entire summary of the recommendations is just going to be very useful. And as you rightly said, some of the recommendations have already been picked up or have been taken up by the government in the FAME policy that they announced recently, the FAME 2. So I think all in all, I think this is shaping out really well. So yeah, thanks again, Aishwarya and Nitish, for taking time to join the podcast. And really feels good to have someone like Ola and Ola Mobility Institute come on the podcast. And you believe in a sustainable transportation and sustainable future. And this aligns well with what the podcast is all about. So thanks again for sharing your views, and look forward to hear more interesting stories and other success stories that you have in this space.
Thank you very much for having us, Girish.
So yes, electric cars make perfect economic sense for fleet operations. It is only a matter of time before you see all the ride-hailing companies offering electric vehicles across various cities. I would strongly recommend you to read the report that we discussed on this podcast. The link to the report is in the show notes section of the podcast. Now on to this week's action item towards Mission Shunya. If you are planning to buy a car, I would strongly encourage you to consider an electric one. Did you know that an average Indian drives for about 30 kilometers a day in a car? An electric version would well fit the bill. The running cost of an electric car is just a fraction compared to a petrol or a diesel variant. So the electric car could in fact turn out to be good for the planet and your pockets. Of course, you can always rent a car for the occasional long drives. But if you're not planning to buy a car, I still got an action item for you. If you like the podcast, why not tell your friends and colleagues about it? Give a rating and write a review on Apple Podcast or any platform of your choice. Your feedback helps me make the podcast better. The podcast is now available on all major platforms like iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, Google Podcast, and so on. So in the next episode, which will be close to the World Environment Day, I have a special guest and a special topic lined up. To make sure you don't miss out on that, subscribe to the podcast on any platform that you're listening to it. So until next time, signing off, this is Mission Shunya, towards a zero carbon economy.